Coming up next on Jonathan Bird's Blue World, a visit to the world's only undersea laboratory.
Hi, I'm Jonathan Bird, and welcome to my world.
As a kid, I dreamed about exploring the oceans from an undersea lab far away from the distractions of the world above. Now that might seem like a science fiction fantasy, even less likely than a space station.
As it turns out, a bunch of scientists and engineers thought an undersea lab might be a great way to study the ocean and life in the ocean. With funding from the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, they created the Aquarius Reef Base near Key Largo, Florida. My childhood dream has become a reality. Here, six people can live and work for weeks at a time without ever going to the surface. Sure, it seems really cool, but to truly understand how this underwater habitat benefits the study of the ocean, you really need to understand a little bit about the physiology of scuba diving. Scuba gear has given humans the ability to explore the shallow parts of the ocean. We can hover weightless like fish, breathing underwater for as long as our scuba tank lasts, which is generally about an hour.
But even with an unlimited scuba tank, we can't stay down too long because of something called decompression sickness, or the bent.
When I submerge underwater, the increasing water pressure at depth pushing in on my lungs won't allow me to breathe unless my regulator supplies air to me at the same pressure as the water around me. The deeper I go, the more water pressure there is, and therefore the air I'm breathing is at a higher pressure too, pushing out at the same pressure as the water pushing in. Since about 79% of the atmosphere is composed of nitrogen and our bodies can't metabolize nitrogen, all this high-pressured nitrogen builds up in my muscles and other tissues when I dive. If I stay underwater for too long, too much nitrogen builds up in my body.
When I come up to the lower ambient pressure at the surface, it can form bubbles in my blood, sort of like this. Those bubbles get stuck in arteries and veins, blocking circulation and causing great pain.
But what if I didn't have to come back here to the lower ambient pressure at the surface after a dive? What if I could stay at a high ambient pressure by living in an undersea lab? Well, I could scuba dive all day long and I'd never get the bends. That's the idea behind the Aquarius Reef Base. The Blue World team has been invited to film an Aquarius mission, so cameraman Tim and I have come to beautiful Key Largo, Florida for an adventure. We load the Aquarius support boat and join the staff as we depart from the dock for a 45-minute ride out to the Aquarius. Once we clear the canal and reach the ocean, we still have a few miles to go. The Florida Keys have huge areas of shallow coral reefs before the seafloor drops off into deeper water. So, Aquarius is located a bit further from shore than you might expect. Our ride takes us over miles of beautiful coral reef. I can hardly contain my excitement to see this astonishing underwater habitat. At last, we reach the life support buoy. This floating structure contains generators and compressors supplying power and air to Aquarius below. We tie up our boat to the life support buoy. Aquarius is sitting on the sea floor 60 feet beneath our boat. Tim and I suit up and prepare to not only see Aquarius up close, but go inside and meet the team of divers called Aquanauts, with whom we'll be working for the week.
Well, I'm all geared up and ready to go. This is so cool. You have got to see this.
As soon as I hit the ocean, I can see Aquarius directly beneath me in the clear water. It's almost like a submarine that doesn't move. But unlike a submarine, the pressure inside Aquarius is the same as the pressure outside. So even though there's an open hatch at the bottom of the habitat, water doesn't go in. This allows people to go in and out of Aquarius as much as they like.
Which is totally awesome! So this is it, the Aquarius. Amazing. I can come right in through an open hole in the floor, and yet the water stays out. That's cool. Now, time for a shower. You have to shower before you go inside the Aquarius because really they don't want salt water and everything. I mean, we might be underwater, but this is civilized.
So the Aquarius, you can think of it as basically like a big school bus with no seats in it. It's sort of like a long tube and everything is spread throughout that tube. At this end, behind this power door, is the front porch. And that's where I came inside. We like to keep that closed because it's quite humid in there and it's air conditioned in here. Now the next feature you'll find right inside the front door here is the bathroom. There's your bathroom. You get your privacy curtain. You know, it's pretty small bathroom, but gets the job done. And of course, right across over here, a sink. And of course, some laboratory equipment, you know, just in case you need to do some biological studies. And then we come down a little further. We have a computer. Well, you gotta be able to get on the internet even when you're underwater. I mean, come on. So here in the middle of the Aquarius, we have the kitchen, or what you would call on a boat, the galley. So if you come in here, we've got the sink, and we have a sort of a place to eat, a kitchen table, if you will, and a picture window. But unlike your picture window at home, this picture window looks out on a coral reef with fish swimming by. Where's the fish? Come here, fishies. And the last part, down here at the far end, this would be sort of like the back of the school bus. You have six bunks all stacked up together. You can see there's not a lot of space in here. In fact, if you're sleeping, you only have about a foot and a half from your head to the next bunk up. It's pretty tight, but it's cozy and it's dry.
And you can't beat the view out the window at the foot of the bed.
So now you might be wondering, what do you eat down here? Well, they eat sort of like astronauts. It's freeze-dried food. If you're a camper, you might have used some of this stuff. You rip the package open, you put hot water in it, you let it sit for a while, then you can eat it right out of the package. They don't really have a lot of facilities for cooking. They have a microwave and they have hot water and that's about it. There's no stove, there's no oven. Some of the food that gets brought down in very tight containers gets compressed with the pressure down here. So this is something that was fully inflated at the surface, but once it gets brought down here to 50 feet, the pressure in here squishes it down, and that's what it ends up looking like. And you can feel the pressure all around you, even though you don't really feel like you're under pressure. The air that we're breathing is a little bit more dense because it's compressed. And several things happen. My voice sounds a little funny to me, but on top of that, it's really hard to whistle. There we go.
Even though the scientists are out scuba diving, there are always two technicians in Aquarius maintaining the life support, fixing little things that break, monitoring the various systems, and keeping track of the divers. While technician Mark Hulsbeck is giving me an introduction to the life support systems, we're being watched by someone on shore. There are cameras all over Aquarius. They send their signals through a cable up to the life support buoy, where the signal is beamed wirelessly back to the antenna on shore. Here at the watch desk, another technician monitors activity, electrical systems, and life support. This is an additional layer of safety. If there's some kind of emergency, help will be on the way immediately. Meanwhile, down at Aquarius, I have to leave. I can only stay a little more than an hour because I have to return to the lower pressure at the surface or I'll have decompression sickness. The biologists, however, are out working on the reef conducting their study of reef sponges. They wear double scuba tanks so they can carry a lot of air. Even though they dive 100 feet deep, they can spend hours and hours doing their research, utterly unconcerned about such trivial things as decompression sickness. They can spend as much time as they like on the reef because they don't need to go to the lower pressure of the surface after the dive. Instead, these aquanauts will return to Aquarius. When their scuba tanks get low, the aquanauts head over to the nearest gazebo. It's sort of like an oasis for divers. It's filled with air. Inside, they can take their masks off, talk to each other, and fill their scuba tanks from a high-pressure hose from Aquarius. After an air fill, the aquanauts can go back out on the reef for a few more hours. Eventually, though, they get hungry and come back to Aquarius for lunch.
Scientists are still down there. It's hard to believe they can stay for a whole week, but I can only stay for an hour.
The next day, I have another hour to spend in Aquarius, so I go during lunch to meet these sponge-studying aquanauts.
What is it that you can do here that you can't do from the surface? Now, why do you gotta go through all this?
We have over 900 sponges that we visit every year, and it just takes so long that we really need a lot of bottom time. And like this morning, we did a 6-hour dive, but if we were to do that from boats from the surface, that would have taken us probably, 6 to 10 dives.
After lunch, the aquanauts gear back up and head out for another few hours' work. They may swim quite a ways to their research site, but they have safety lines to lead them back home to Aquarius. Aquarius isn't just a home for aquanauts. Over the years, coral and sponges have grown all over the structure. It's been transformed into an artificial reef with thousands of fish taking up residence. They're all used to divers. One of the resident tarpon comes right up to my camera for a close look. Cameraman Tim investigates a purple coloration on the hull of Aquarius, only to be attacked by an angry sergeant major, a kind of damselfish. The purple coloration is an egg nest. The tiny eggs are stuck to the hull by the female and guarded by the male, and he's not happy. Aquarius is home to fish as well as people. While the marine residents have all they need, the humans inside need constant supplies from the surface. Drinking water is brought down each day by surface support divers. Air gets pumped down all the time by the life support buoy overhead. It continually overflows out the bottom of the wet porch so the air inside stays fresh. If the pumps in the life support buoy failed, there's a huge supply of air in reserve tanks next to Aquarius. Getting dry things like food, cameras, and towels down to Aquarius presents a bit more of a challenge, but the team came up with a brilliantly simple solution. It looks like a giant pressure cooker.
So this is a modified paint pot. So they apparently don't use them anymore. They don't make them.
This heavy steel container has a valve on top for equalizing internal pressure and 8 strong clamps to keep it closed.
So when we close the valve up top, shut everything down, tighten it down all these dogs all the way around.
Yeah. Depending on how heavy the stuff inside is, a diver may be able to handle it alone. or an air-filled lift bag might be required to keep it from sinking. Once the pot is delivered, the valve is opened to bring it up to the same internal pressure as Aquarius, and the clamps come off. With any luck, everything is dry. In the last 10 years, only one has leaked.
Thank you, Brad.
You're welcome, Order.
At the end of their week in Aquarius, the Aquanauts must go through one long decompression to bring their bodies back to surface pressure. They rest for about 18 hours, watching Blue World DVDs, of course, while the pressure inside Aquarius is brought back down to that of the surface. For a few hours, they wear masks and breathe pure oxygen. Aquarius serves as one huge decompression chamber. In spite of all the effort required to keep Aquarius running, this underwater lab is actually not very expensive to run, about $10,000 per mission day. That might sound like a lot, but it's actually inexpensive when the number of diving hours are all added up. Four scientific divers can rack up 32 to 40 combined hours underwater each day. We know very little about the oceans just because they're so difficult to study. But we do know that the oceans are incredibly important to our planet, our atmosphere, and all life on Earth. The more we know about the oceans, the better we can protect and nurture the entire Earth's environment. Aquarius Reef Base is the world's only underwater research station serving on the front lines of cutting-edge ocean research. And with continued funding, it will be helping scientists study the ocean for many years to come.